You're traveling to another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. Your next stop.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Word of the Lord. James over here with you. And so glad you are continuing to study with us. And I hope that you will enjoy this Bible study. Actually, when I walked into the studio, actually before I got here, I got a phone call. And the gentleman that was talking to me was talking about Mark's program. And I knew what Mark was talking about before I ever got here. And I'm going to continue talking about that letter and that book that that Mark received, because I received the same one. I received a letter. All that's changed in the letter was just the name. Mr. Hopkins took my name out and put Mark's name in, or vice versa. I don't know if he sent one to any of the other guys or not, but nonetheless, we're going to talk more about the book, I guess you might say, than the letter. I've had some discussions with Mr. Hopkins in the past, and so we're going to continue talking about some of the things that he believes and what he teaches. But before we do that, I want to give you our contact information. You can reach me at wordofthelord at gmail.com. 276-340-2653 is how you can reach me. And so we hope that you will do that very thing. If you want to worship with us, you need directions to the building, you can give me a call. I'd be glad to give you those directions. 250 the Boulevard is where we meet. And that's on Sundays at 9 and 10. And the Bible studies on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. Glad to study with you anytime we can. So let's just get right into our lesson. You know, friends, I don't mind individuals scrutinizing or examining what we teach. Don't have a problem with that at all. As a matter of fact, the Apostle Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 21, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good. And you hear us say on a regular basis, we expect you, we encourage you to examine what you hear from us. We don't want you to take our word for it. We want you to look into the Bible. But at the same time, we want you to be honest with what you find. If there's a contradiction in what you say or what you believe, then the Bible is going to be true. Now, the problem that we have with individuals oftentimes is, ultimately, they don't believe the Bible, or they really don't want to let go of what they believe. Now, that is what Mr. Hopkins has been accusing us of. And I don't mind being accused of that. What's going to tip the balance in who's telling the truth or not is if it contradicts the Bible, then it's not truth. All right? Now, sometimes when you are asked a question, sometimes you're asked a question, and the Bible says be ready to always give an answer, 1 Peter 3, verse 15. And sometimes when you ask that question will come up again. You know, it is a case that sometimes things reoccur and reoccur and reoccur, and that's what we're dealing with. You know, in Luke 4 and verse 13, the Bible says that as Christ was in the, he was being tempted of the devil, and after the temptation, the Bible said when he had ended all the temptation, he departed from him for a season. So the devil left Christ for a season, but he'll come back. And that's really sometimes the way a question is. A question or a comment or a, you might say a criticism comes up. And people want to ask the same question. And that's fine, because we know it's the case that sometimes it will come up again. Even though you may know the answer, if you are given the answer, look what Peter says. In 2 Peter 1 and verse 12, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 12. Well, I get it here. Talk about that. He says, wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them. So you may know something, and then it comes up again, we have to repeat it. So we don't mind going over the same things, teaching the same things, or answering the same arguments or doctrines, because it is necessary to help people understand what the truth really is. And so that's really why we're spending some time talking about what Mr. Hopkins believes. Now, in the past, I've answered Don Hopkins on TV. I've had email discussions with him. I actually went back and looked at some of those email discussions. Some of the same arguments that he was making back then that he will not accept truth on. He's making the same in the letter and in the book. He's making those same things. I spent 7 months, by my calculation, 7 months going back and forth with emails with Mr. Hopkins. And you know, I don't mind spending that time with someone, but like I said, you have to be honest enough to realize that when you're being inconsistent, then something has to change. Now, back in 2011, he wrote Mark, and he wrote me, both in the same year, and I suspect that's why he sent these same letters and books to us again. And as I said, the letter, it's a, like Mark said, it's a 5-page letter, and the book is actually a 4-volume book. It actually has 4 little booklets together, a little spiral-bound book. It looks nice, but he's wanting $18 for it. But I'm going to be honest with you, friends. I wouldn't give a plug nickel for it. I'm glad he sent it to me because I surely wouldn't have bought this. I wouldn't spend my good money on this, especially when it's just rehash of a lot of the emails that he sent. And actually, a lot of the letters, Mark, you're going to find when you read this letter and you read the book, a lot of the content of the book is in the letter. So, but nonetheless, we want to go over this. Now, I don't have any ill will for Mr. Hopkins. No, there's nothing personal about it, but other than the fact that what he's teaching is a false doctrine. I'm going to show you this. I'm going to show you a lot of the inconsistencies that Mr. Hopkins has in his letters and his books and his teachings that are not consistent with the Bible. Now, as we said, first of all, you know, one of the things that people often do when they can't defend their doctrine or when they're trying to make their doctrine fit something they already believe is they start to diminish the Word of God. Now, I want to show you the inconsistencies that we're dealing with. First of all, notice this. Don says in the introduction of this book, that's the very, not the first page, the pages are numbered, but this is actually, I guess, page A. It's right inside the table of contents of the first little booklet. But I've gone through. You can see that I've read and highlighted some of it. But this is what he says in the introduction. He says Christianity is the only religion which was started by eyewitnesses to Jesus' miracles and his teachings. These disciples were taught by Jesus himself and commissioned to preach the gospel of Christ in the kingdom of God. These disciples and apostles wrote most of the New Testament. There is no better source for truth about salvation and Christian living than the New Testament in the King James Bible because these writers were taught by Jesus Christ. All right, now, very, very good. I would agree with that statement. I might reword it some a little bit, but, you know, I agree with that. Christianity was founded by Christ. It was spread by the apostles who were eyewitnesses and inspired writers who were inspired of God to write the New Testament. And I agree that the King James Bible is the inspired Word of God. Now, we're going to show you some problems that even Mr. Hopkins is going to have with the King James Bible. He touts it like it's the end-all to be-all, but he still doesn't really fully agree with the King James Bible. Now, notice this. So here he says Christianity was started by and taught by disciples who were taught by Jesus himself and commissioned to preach the gospel of Christ in the kingdom of God. Now notice that's on the introduction. Now you get to page 69. Now notice the inconsistency here. He says Peter was wrong about the prophet Joel's prophecy. Now, friends, I start to wonder now where is this man coming from? Why would he say that? See this? Now, I want you to notice. Let's just look at the context. Now, that's what Don said. Don says New Testament writers are wrong, and he starts off with Peter. Peter was wrong about Joel's prophecy. Well, let's see. Acts chapter 2, and let's look at verse 4. Now, we know the setting. Most people are pretty familiar with Acts 2. They were all in one place. And Jesus told them to tarry in Jerusalem till you be endued with power on high. Let's just start in verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and sat upon each of them. Verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. So they're speaking in other tongues, other languages, as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now, while they are filled with the Holy Spirit, I want you to notice this. There were devout men, Jews, dwelling in Jerusalem out of every nation. When this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them, that the apostles, speak in his own language. All right? Now, and they were all amazed and marveled, and saying one another, behold, are not all these which speak Galilean? So they are hearing these apostles speaking these languages wherein they're born, and these apostles speaking by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, while Peter and the others have been filled with the Holy Ghost to speak and speak with tongues, speaking these languages, notice this. This is when Peter says, these are not drunken as you suppose, because the crowd said, all are drunk. And Peter said, standing up with the 11, said, these are, lifted up his voice and said, ye men of Judea, all ye which dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my words, for these men be not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. Now, Peter was speaking by the power of the Holy Spirit. Mr. Hopkins says, well, he got it wrong. Well, Mr. Hopkins, if Peter got it wrong, then the Holy Spirit must have got it wrong. See how it works, friends? See how it works? When you say Peter got it wrong, then you have to say the Holy Spirit got it wrong. Because Peter and the other 11 were speaking by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, I start immediately to question then, how does Mr. Hopkins really feel about the Bible? See, when I start reading this. Now, notice this. Let's move on down. Because this is not the first time that he's going to criticize the New Testament writers. Look what he says. This is on page 69, same page. He says, if some of the disciples were wrong in their understanding. Now, he's telling you why he's writing the book. He's going to tell you, he's going to teach you things out of the book. Let me just get the whole quote here. This is on page 69. Let me just make sure I get the quote here. He's going to tell us why he's writing the book. My goal is to offer the truth from many different books of the Bible and from many different writers. If some of the disciples were wrong in their understanding of what Jesus taught, then it is reasonable to believe that modern-day teachers can also be wrong. Then he says, even the Apostle Paul was wrong. Paul had Timothy circumcised because of the Jews. Paul believed this in the world. He was wrong. These are not inspired passages. All right? These are not inspired passages. What he said right here. These are not inspired passages. Now, friends, that gives me a little more insight to what's going on in Mr. Hopkins' mind. He does not believe that all of the Bible is inspired. Now, friends, when you have a man that starts saying that, you can immediately know. There we go. So he says, in New Testament writers are wrong. Now let's look at another example here. Same page, number six, page 69. He says the Apostle Paul was wrong in 1 Timothy 2 and verse 4 when he said, God will have all men to be saved. This was Paul's opinion, not inspired teachings from God. He says Paul was not a disciple of Christ. Well, he wasn't a disciple of Christ from the beginning like the rest of them were, but he was an apostle. Even Mr. Hopkins calls him an apostle. So I would say that gives even more credibility to him, even though he may not have been a disciple from the beginning, but he was an apostle of Christ. But yet he says this was simply Paul's opinion and not inspired teaching. God does not want all men to be saved. We'll come back to that. That's a pretty powerful statement in and of itself. He actually says on the same page, come on down, he says Jesus doesn't want everybody to be saved. Just put that in your hat and we'll come back to it maybe. But I want you to listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 8. Here we have. He says, Paul says that Christ was seen of all these witnesses after his resurrection. And he says, and last of all, he was seen of me also as one born unto time. So Paul saw Christ. He met him on the road to Damascus. So he saw the resurrected Christ. He said, for I am the least of the apostles that am not meet to be called an apostle because I persecute the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than all they. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Now, I want you to think about something, friends. All through his book, and all through his letter, he keeps talking about saved by grace, saved by grace, saved by grace. Well, Paul says he was saved by grace, and yet Mr. Hopkins says he wasn't inspired. Mr. Hopkins says, well, he was wrong about some things. He says that the Apostle Paul, who said he was saved by the grace of God, who saw Jesus on the road to Damascus, Mr. Hopkins says, well, he was wrong. Friends, does that not seem strange to you that a man is going to all this trouble to say that an apostle is wrong, that he's just speaking by opinion? Notice this, in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 37, and like I said, I know Mark might have gone over some of these, but it bears repeating. He said, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Now, was Paul wrong about that? Was this just opinion? See, I don't know how Mr. Hopkins determines what's opinion, what's right and what's wrong by the Apostle Paul. If the Apostle Paul is wrong about one thing, well, maybe he's wrong about this. Is what he says not the commandments of God? You mean he's lying to us? You see the consequences of what you're saying? See the consequences of this doctrine, friends? When a man says that the Apostle Paul is wrong, that he's not inspired, that he's just giving opinions, then he has to answer, well, why did the Apostle Paul say the things I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord? See, now that is very, very dangerous doctrine. That's a very dangerous road to go down, Mr. Hopkins. And I honestly and sincerely want you to consider, is this what you're saying about Paul? Is Paul lying about this? How do we know if Paul's telling us the truth on this, if he's wrong about something else? And you already said that he's inspired. You already said that the New Testament was written by inspired writers, taught by Jesus. Paul says he was taught by Jesus. As a matter of fact, you don't believe that? Let's look at this. In Galatians, we'll just go ahead and put this up. Galatians 1 and verse 11. He said, I certify you, brethren, that the gospel which was preached of me is not after man. For I neither received it of man, neither was I taught it, but by the revelation of Jesus Christ. Was Paul right about that, or was he wrong about that? If Paul was right about this, if in fact what he got, if his gospel came from Christ, that it was a revelation of Jesus Christ, if he's right about that, then how can you turn around and say he's wrong about something else? See how scary that is, folks? I would hate to be going down the road of saying, well, I'm picking and choosing, and I'll tell you when Peter was right and Peter was wrong, Paul was right, Paul was wrong, Paul's giving an opinion here, he's not inspired here. remember, Mr. Hopkins is starting to go down the road of saying, well, the Bible's not inspired. He's already said it a number of ways. Here he says it again. This is on page 98. Notice it's page 98. I'm going to get over where I can read it for you. Page 98. Everything, 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God. Everything in the Bible is not scripture. Everything in the Bible is not scripture. Some of the Bible is the history of the Jewish nation. Some of the Bible is parables or prophecy. Some are proverbs. Some are instructions, which were inspired by God. The Old Testament contains laws, commandments, ordinances, sacrifices, and dietary laws for the Jewish people, which does not apply to New Testament Christians. Okay? God did not have to inspire the Jewish people to keep the record of genealogy. How do you know he didn't? And if he didn't, how do you know that the genealogy that you have in the Bible is not inspired? See how silly that is? That's silly to say that you didn't have, he didn't have to inspire them. Almost all of the Old Testament does not apply to us today. Well, really? Well, what part does apply to us then? He's already said that the New Testament is what we should live by, what we go by. All right? The New Testament is what we... it's what we live by, and yet he's saying now there's some parts of the Old Testament that we have to live by. So I don't know. So everything in the Bible is not scripture. Friend, does that trouble you? Now, if Mr. Hopkins is a primitive Baptist, which I believe he is, I believe that's what he's confessed to, he's what he's defending, primitive Baptist, is that what most of you in the primitive Baptist church believe? That the Bible is not inspired, it's just bits and pieces inspired? Listen to what else he says here. He says, same page. He's 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. Now this is 2 Timothy 3:16. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Now this is this is page 98. Still page 98. Many preachers apply this verse to the entire Bible. Now I know Mark dealt some of this. He says, There was no New Testament when this was written, so this passage does not apply to the New Testament. All right? This did not apply to the New Testament. Well, you mean to tell me that these men that wrote the Bible were not inspired? If they're writing by inspiration, and remember, he's already said they were. If they were writing by inspiration, then wouldn't this verse then also include or be applied to what they wrote, even though there was no New Testament at the time that it was written? This was part of the New Testament that was being written. If they were inspired and all scripture is given by inspiration of God, then whatever inspired men write, therefore, are scripture. You mean to tell me that they're inspired, but they're not writing inspired? They're inspired writers, but yet what they write is not inspired scripture? How silly is that? Scripture just means writings. So if you're talking about the writers of the New Testament were inspired, then what they wrote was inspired scripture, inspired writings. Mr. Hopkins comes along and says, well, they were inspired, but what they wrote was not inspired. Everything they wrote was not inspired, not scripture. Really? Well, let's look at this. In John 14 verse 27. John 14 26. Jesus says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. So what they were writing as a result of the Holy Spirit bringing to their remembrance what Jesus said. Now, we're going to see another verse here in a minute, or another quote from Mr. Hopkins is just totally mind-boggling. Jesus said that these men were writing what the Holy Spirit told them to write. Let's look at John 16. John 16 and verse 13. He said, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. So he's going to tell them the Holy Spirit is the one who's operating through these men. Now, you want to say that Paul wasn't inspired? That he was just giving some opinion? You call him an apostle, but yet then you turn around and say, well, he's giving an opinion here? Where do you get the authority? Where do you get the right? Or how do you come to the conclusion that this is opinion, this is a non-inspiration? Paul was given the same ability by the Holy Spirit to do what Peter, James, John, Matthew, Mark, all these were to do. He had the same Spirit that was guiding him in his writings. How do I know this? Acts 9. Acts 9 and verse 17. Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, hath appeared unto thee in the way thou camest. Now, why did he appear to him, Ananias? He hath sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. Why? Because Paul was going to be an apostle to the Gentiles. He was going to stand before, he's going to preach to the Jews and Gentiles. Let's back up to verse 14 and 15. Let's look at verse 10. There was a certain disciple of Damascus named Ananias. To him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. Verse 10, the Lord said unto him, Arise, go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire of the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth. And he hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard many of this man, heard by many of this man, how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. And the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to hear my name before to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. And I will show him great things he must suffer for my name's sake. So here's the Apostle Paul being told, you're a chosen vessel, and Mr. Hodgson would say he wasn't inspired. You're under the word from the Lord. You're under the word from the Lord.
Hey, James. I was just trying to talk. I don't really have a question. I just want to get somebody at the station there. Your audio is really off tonight, and I didn't know if they'd want to try to improve it or anything.
Okay. All right. I appreciate that. Maybe they'll...
It's very tinny.
Maybe they'll
very
tweak on it a little
sounding.
Bit. Okay, thank you. Thank you for letting us know that.
Hey, sure, welcome.
Okay. Caller said we have some audio trouble. I don't know exactly what that means, but maybe we can tweak on that a little bit. So here we're talking about, friends. The Apostle Paul inspired, according to the Bible, but according to Don Hopkins, he's not. Now let's look at another one here. Everything in the Bible is not Scripture. Remember, Don Hopkins keeps saying this. He says, same page, 98. He says, most of Peter's, Paul's, Mark's, and Luke's writings in the New Testament is inspired. Well, I can tell you right now, Mr. Hopkins is not writing by the Holy Spirit. Most of Peter, Paul, Mark's, and Luke's writings in the New Testament are inspired. Let's get the proper verb here, which, not trying to pile on here, but Mr. Hopkins says that he was one of his jobs early on was proof text reading for a newspaper, so hope he did a little better job for the newspaper than he did his own book. But Peter, most of their writings are inspired. Most of their writings are inspired. But he says all of Christ's teachings in the New Testament are true and inspired. The Bible says rightly divide, there are many errors in the New Testament. I know Mark talked about some of that. But let's notice something, friends, here. Let's notice something. Most of it's inspired. Listen, the Bible is constantly reminding us that the things that are written were written by inspired men. Now, if you want to say that the writers are not inspired, then you have to take into criticism, you're starting to criticize the entire Bible, because the Bible says that it was written by inspired men. Notice this, in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 10, he says, of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ which was in them, that's the prophets, Old Testament prophets, did signify when it testified beforehand the suffering of Christ and the glory that should follow. Verse 12. Unto whom it was revealed that not unto themselves, but unto us they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them. Now, who's doing the reporting now when Peter's talking? Who's doing the reporting? Peter and the other inspired writers. Which are now being reported unto you by them that have preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven. Now, Peter says that he and the other people who are preaching the gospel are doing so by the Holy Spirit. Was Peter right on that point, Mr. Hopkins? Or was he wrong? Was that just Peter's opinion? Peter, that's just your opinion that you're inspired. Oh, you're wrong about that, Peter. You're not really inspired. Well, if Peter's wrong about being inspired, Mr. Hopkins, then everything Peter wrote, we need to throw out. You can't use anything Peter said if you said he's wrong, because he said he's speaking by inspiration. Let's look again in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 3. Hebrews 2 and verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by them that heard him? How was it confirmed? By them that heard him. God also bearing them witness with both with signs and wonders and with diverse miracles and the gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his own will. So the Hebrew writer says, look, the message that you're getting at first was being confirmed, spoken by Jesus, and now it's being confirmed to you by the Holy Ghost. Would the Holy Spirit be operating in people who aren't inspired? Would the Holy Spirit be delivering a message by men who were just giving their opinion? Really, Mr. Hopkins? Is that really how you feel about the Bible? See, friends, this is why this doctrine really concerns us. Now, look what he says on page 98. He says, it's an error to say God said something when Peter, Mark, or Luke said it. It's an error to say, another error they make is saying that God says something when Peter or Mark said it. Really? Really? Is that really an error? You're on the word of the Lord.
Yes, James. You know, everybody's talking about terrorists and everything and how society is. There's no foundation, morals, or respect, or order, or anything in life nowadays, because people want to change the Constitution and change the Bible and everything, and the kids are being raised, they don't know what to believe.
Right.
They don't, I mean, even the churches, Austin Church, they don't all meet in one congregation. They got kids off in rooms playing.
Right.
A church is going on. How's the kids getting taught?
Right. I agree with that.
I mean, going to the store, we got our britches dusted off if we touched or grabbed or cried for something.
Okay.
Listen.
I appreciate your comment, but I want to stay on topic here. I want to stay on topic. Okay.
All right.
I appreciate your call. All right. Now, how is it that a man can say that another error that preachers make is saying God said something when Peter, Mark, or Luke said it? Is that really an error to say that? Is it really wrong to say that God said something even though Peter, Mark, or Luke was the mouthpiece? In Matthew 10, verse 17, Jesus said, but beware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils, and they will scourge you in their synagogues, and you shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. But when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what you shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what you shall speak. For it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you. Jesus says that God is going to speak in you, or speak through you. And if you're coming down to verse 40, let's come on down to verse 40. Notice what he says. He says, when you go into a town, what happens? Verse 40. He said, he that receiveth you receiveth me, and he that receiveth me receiveth him that sent me. These men were apostles of Christ. They were the witnesses of him. They were the ones who were speaking the things that God said to speak. As a matter of fact, let's look at one more. John chapter 17. John 17. In verse 17, he says, "Sanctify them with thy truth. Thy word is truth." Now, I know Mr. Hopkins likes that verse. That must be true, because I know he's quoted it. But notice what Jesus says. He says, "As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have sent them into the world." Well, if they're speaking, maybe they're speaking for God, Mr. Hopkins. You ever think about that? Notice what he says. "Neither pray I for these prayer for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they may also be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they may also be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me." Let's back up here. Verse 14 here. "I have given them thy word." You mean to tell me that Jesus is praying to God and he says, "I gave them your word," and then you, Mr. Hopkins, want to say that it's wrong for me to say that Peter said, that God said something, when Peter actually is the one who said it? Paul said, remember, 1 Corinthians 14:37? Maybe that's one of those opinion verses again, but he said that he was speaking the commandments of the Lord. Really, folks? Is this really the kind of Bible scholarship that we should be listening to? The man says that it's wrong, that the writers aren't inspired. Remember, let's go back to this one. Everything in the Bible is not Scripture. Everything in the Bible is not Scripture. Mark covered this. not Scripture, but I'll go over one more time as well. Let's just rehash it here. 2 Peter 3 and verse 16. Now notice this. He says, "As also in all his epistles," this is Peter talking. Let's look at verse 15. Talking about Paul. "Paul, according to the wisdom given unto him, written unto you," he hath written unto you. So Paul's writing these letters that Mr. Hopkins says may or may not be inspired. I don't really know how he tells. He says, "Also in all his epistles, speaking to them these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, which they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do," "as they do other scriptures." Now, wait a minute. Other scriptures? Peter just said that Paul's writings are scripture. And he said they twist Paul's words that he wrote, his inspired scriptures, just like they twist other scriptures. I believe Peter just said Paul's writings are inspired and that they are scripture. Well, I don't know. Maybe Peter was wrong about that too. I don't know. Seems to be a common thread through all of Mr. Hopkins' writings and his teachings. Trying to come to a conclusion about what the Bible's really saying, he discounts and throws out a great majority of it by saying it's just opinions or, you know, uninspired philosophies, I guess. He says in his book, and I believe this is page 105 of his book, page 105, I'm going to read this. I tried to get that as big as I could. He says, "Many scriptures are repeated in the four Gospels, and some are repeated in the book of Acts." Again, I don't really know how he determines which ones in these books are inspired or not. I think the uninspired ones are the ones that contradict what he says. I'm just guessing. "The Apostle Paul wrote the same message to different churches, so they are repeated. I have used this method in this book. Some scriptures are worth repeating." That's right. But here's the question. Is Don repeating opinions? Or is Don repeating errors? Is he repeating these uninspired thoughts that he says are all throughout the Bible? I mean, how are we supposed to know that what he's repeating to us over and over again are really inspired words? Are they inspired because he says so? I think that might be the criteria. If he says it, it must be the case. But here's my question, friends. Should we believe Mr. Hopkins? Should we believe Don Hopkins? I want you to listen to what he says. Now, this is from, I believe this is from his book, but I didn't put the page down here. Yeah, this is 97, I believe. Let me get over to it. 97. Yeah, page 97. He said, to fulfill these instructions about studying to show yourself approved, he said, to fulfill these instructions, I have studied the Bible for many years. I've read the King James Bible from Genesis to Revelation 6 times and the New Testament 3 additional times. And I've also listened to the Bible on DVD 4 times. I have prayed to God for instructions in righteousness and enlightenment and spiritual truth. I believe God has answered my prayers. Notice, I have had spiritual dreams and visions and heard a small, still voice where God instructed me through the Holy Spirit. Should we believe Don? Well, he says he's guided by the Holy Spirit. He has some dreams and visions. Notice what he says here. He says, the Bible says, same page, 97, the Bible says, he that thinketh he knoweth anything, knoweth nothing as he ought. It does not say that he knoweth, but thinketh he knoweth. God revealed to me in this dream. Now, this is underlined by him, bold and underlined by him. God revealed this to me in a dream, that where you are standing, or your viewpoint, or point of view, controls what you see, literally, physically, socially, politically, emotionally, and spiritually. This is a great truth that God revealed to me in this dream. So, he has been having some dreams and visions and hearing still small voices that tell him to buy some land and dig out fairy stones, whatever. And he says we're supposed to believe him because he's had a dream about it. He's had a vision about it. Now, is that a good reason? Well, consider this. Let's go back and remember the very first page of introduction of this book that he writes. Second paragraph. He says, Jesus appeared to the Apostle Paul in a vision. Paul was converted and instructed to preach the gospel of salvation by the grace of God. The Apostle Paul then became one of the leading preachers of this time, and he wrote most of the books of the New Testament. But remember, Paul was very likely to give you some opinion in there. And he was likely to give you some uninspired opinion. He was likely to give you something that wasn't really inspired. But wait a minute, he had the same vision you did, Don. Paul had a vision. And you say, well, some of his stuff's wrong. You had a vision, and all of a sudden we're supposed to believe Don Hopkins. See, friend, you know what Job said? Job said, oh, that mine enemy had written a book. Mr. Hopkins, when you put this in writing, it shows how fallible you are. And it shows really the nature of your scholarship in the Bible. You want us, you want the community to believe that what you say in this book is true, yet you contradict yourself time and time again. Remember, Paul was wrong. Remember, page 69? Paul's wrong. Yeah, this was Paul's opinion and non-inspired teaching from God. But Paul had a vision from Christ. Well, you know what? If Paul can have a vision from Christ and be told to preach a certain message, and then turn around and give us some uninspired opinions, well, you know what? I think Mr. Hopkins might be in the same category. As a matter of fact, I think I'm more inclined to listen and accept Peter and Paul's opinions rather than Don's dreams. Now, friends, you see why we're saying this? Why would I believe Don and his dreams and visions when he says, I can't even believe Paul's writings, who saw Christ in a vision? See what I'm saying? See, is that? Now, I think that's an honest and fair question. Mr. Hopkins, why should we believe you? Why should we believe you who tells us that Paul was wrong, Peter's wrong, and some of the New Testament, a lot of the New Testament are wrong, errors on the New Testament? Well, maybe there's errors in what you say. Why should we accept you? But friends, you know what it comes down to? It comes down to this one thing. When you can't defend your doctrine, or when you find that your doctrine is running head on to other scriptures, the easiest thing for you to do is to do what Mr. Hopkins does, and that is attack the Bible. Say the Bible's wrong. The Bible's wrong on these points. The Bible is, you know, it's just an opinion. It's not true. Friends, does that sound anything like what some other people say? You know what the Nation of Islam says about the Bible? It contains the truth of God's word. You know what the Jehovah's Witnesses say? Well, the King James Bible is fine if it's translated right. There's some things that are not translated right in the Bible, so they have their own Bible. You know what the Mormons say? The Mormons say the same thing. They believe the Bible as much as it's translated correctly. Now, isn't it ironic or isn't it interesting that Mr. Hopkins comes along and in order to convince us that he's right, he had to say, well, the Bible's wrong on this point. The Bible's wrong on this point. Listen to what it says here. Listen to what he says. He says, the reason I believe the New King James Bible contains the inspired Word of God. Now, you got to be careful, friends. Listen. You got to be careful. The reason I believe the inspired Word of God, the King James Bible, contains the inspired Word of God is because the doctrine of salvation by grace was taught to me in a vision. Now, did you pick up on that, friends? Did you listen carefully to what he said? The reason I believe the New King James Bible contains the inspired Word of God, that tells you exactly where he's coming from. He doesn't believe that it is the inspired Word of God, but rather that it just contains the inspired Word of God. He doesn't really believe that it's the full inspired Word of God. It just contains it. That's what I heard Mal Vester say. Nation of Islam. That's what he said. Well, it contains the Word of God. Well, that tells you his idea about how he feels about the Bible. Remember, Don said most of Paul's Peter, Paul, and Mark's teachings are in the New Testament are inspired. As you said, is inspired. But all of Christ's teaching in the New Testament are true and inspired. All of these are maybe inspired. All of Christ are. Then on page 99, he says, one of Peter's disciples wrote the book of Mark. See, he's telling us right there, friends, he's telling us how he really feels about the Bible. It's not really the inspired Word of God. He doesn't like the book of Mark because one of Peter's disciples wrote the book of Mark. Prove that. Prove that. And then notice this. Then he said, now this is part of the letter. This is the part of the letter that Mark was, and I know Mark read this. This is like the fifth paragraph, I believe. He says, Paul was wrong many times. Then he gives some examples, supposedly. Luke made many mistakes in the book of Acts. When Luke gave Paul's conversion only one time out of three, does Luke mention being baptized and washed away sins? Paul gave his testimony in Rome, and I doubt seriously that Luke was there. If Luke was not in the crowd, then someone told Luke what Paul said, that Ananias said. How is this how we get a Bible truth from the third or fourth person? Really? Did we not just go over verses that say they were inspired? They can recollect things that happened, things we brought to their remembrance that happened, even though they weren't there. Can you tell me something, Mr. Hopkins? Do you believe that Genesis is inspired? Do you believe that Exodus is inspired? Do you believe that Genesis? Let's just start with Genesis. Do you believe Genesis is inspired? Do you think someone was there when it all happened? Who wrote Genesis? Well, I believe it's the law of Moses. Now, you think Moses was in the beginning? Boy, I tell you what, he's older than Methuselah, Mark. According to Mr. Hopkins, if you're not there, you don't get to write about it. See what I'm talking about, friends? When you don't have a doctrine that fits the Bible, you try to make the Bible fit your doctrine. Even if it means twisting, resting, cutting, shredding the Bible. The inspired writers did not have to be present if the Holy Spirit was going to bring to their remembrance all things that happened. See, Mr. Hopkins, he puts all this stock in the Holy Spirit talk to him, but yet he doesn't let Luke have the Holy Spirit. He wants to take that away from Luke. He wants to take that away from the New Testament writers so that he can say, well, they weren't really there. Do you have to be there? Do you have to be there to record it if you're writing by inspiration? I'm running out of time. I've got about 5 minutes left, so I'm gonna close with this one. I think this is pretty good. I'm trying to show you, friends, the inconsistencies that men run into when they start trying to force a doctrine that's not in the Bible. Page 98. We've read this quote several times. But listen to what he says. Mr. Hopkins says, all of Christ's teachings in the New Testament are true and inspired. All of Christ's teachings in the New Testament are inspired. And they're true and inspired. Okay? Well, then on page 80, now this is page 98, but if you back up to page 80, you know what you're going to find? Back up to page 80 in this little book, and guess what you have him saying? He says, these Campbellites love to quote Mark 16:16 and use it as a chronological order for being saved. When you read and understand the scriptures given above, Mark 16 cannot be a chronological order for being saved because many scriptures declare that the change has already taken place before you are baptized. As you can see from the scriptures above, a person who believes in Christ has everlasting life, receives remission of sins, born of God, passed from life to death. So you can't have Mark 16:16 as a chronological order for salvation. Well, you know, I'm pretty sure those are words in red, aren't they, Mark? He said unto them, this is Jesus, go into all the world and preach the gospel of every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Now, all of a sudden, remember, Mr. Hopkins, all of Christ's words are inspired and true. Yet, when it comes to Mark 16:15-16, all of a sudden, well, this was actually one of Peter's disciples that wrote this, I guess. Really, Mr. Hopkins? Are these the words of Christ? Are these the words of Christ? Do you believe Mark 16:15-16 are the words of Christ? And if so, then why do you deny that baptism is for the remission of sins when Jesus, our Lord and Savior, said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved? Christ put salvation after baptism. Yes, he put it after belief. And yes, a person must repent. They must confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And they must be baptized in order to be saved. Now, because you don't like that doctrine, you're going to have to reject the words of Christ that you said are inspired and true. Now, which is it, friends? You see the trouble we get into? When people don't love the Bible, they will do anything to get around it. Now, there's so much more. There's so much more we could go over in this book and talk about. But think about this, friends. Mr. Hopkins really doesn't believe in the Bible. Now, he's going to get mad about that. You know, he's already threatened to sue me for slander. Yet he wants to write a book and send me the book. He says, on this page of the book, he says, thy word is true, John 17:17. And I've written above it, except the part that Don Hopkins says his opinion. Now, how are we going to know? What's the hermeneutical method that we're going to use to determine what is inspired and what's opinion, Mr. Hopkins? We have to let Mr. Hopkins do that, I guess. You know, Mr. Hopkins says that the reason why we teach what we teach is because we've been taught it by man. We've been taught, we teach what we have been taught. But you know what he wrote, what he wrote in this book? You know what he wrote or why he wrote this book? He said the reason why he wrote this book, and I'm trying to get back here to find it here. Well, I don't think I have it up there. The purpose of this book is to educate and instruct. Now, Mr. Hopkins, if I teach what you have taught me, am I not then, just like you said, teaching what a man taught me? So many inconsistencies in this doctrine, primitive Baptist doctrine. Friends, it's contrary to the Bible. It's contrary to the Bible. And that's why, as members of the Lord's church, the Church of Christ, that's why we do what we do. We're trying to help you to see that, you know what, men will deceive you. Even to the point they'll say, yeah, that's not really in the Bible. That's not really true. If we can't trust the Bible as being the Word of God, friends, we might as well give up. We might as well hang it up and go home. Friends, I hope this has been educational, helpful. I don't know. We might do some more another time. Mark and I might get together, might do something together. I don't know. But until next time, friends, if you'd like to have a Bible study or we can help in any way, here's our contact information, 276-340-2653. Until next time, thanks for watching. Have a good night.